all his actions. By his actions, he was revolting against society. And the base of that revolt was love, isn't it? Now, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, there's a verse about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Vairagya Vidya Nicha Bhakti Yoga Shikshartham Eka Purusha Purana. That, and that verse says, Mahaprabhu has brought devotion which is ornamented by knowledge and renunciation. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu exhibited renunciation all throughout his life. And his leaving of Mayapur, his leaving of Vishnupriya Devi, that was all renunciation. In fact, Vishnupriya was an emblem of renunciation herself. She through her, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was teaching Gaudiya Vaishnavism, Gaudiya Vaishnava Parivar, what is renunciation. He left her even though she was very young, and even after sannyas, when he came to Shantipur, he didn't actually meet her. And Vishnupriya accepted that fact. And after that, all Nirtamdas Thakur and these Srinivas Charya, especially Srinivas Charya, he met Vishnupriya and he took blessings. And we all know by Chaitanya Charitamrita how our devotion was. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu exhibited renunciation by sannyas. In fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did a favor to renounced order of life. Like, he's got. And Nityananda Prabhu was so pained. He couldn't accept the fact Mahaprabhu has taken sannyas, and that's why he broke his dhanda in three parts. He said, what is this? This is like crazy, you know. For you, these all things are not there. So Mahaprabhu did a favor to renounced order. So Mahaprabhu gave us the concept of renunciation. Mahaprabhu gave us, his entire life was teaching us renunciation. His entire life was teaching us renunciation of self fame and self glory. And that is required to do a revolt. Because when you do a revolt, people will not really glorify you. People will condemn you. Will criticize you. But nevertheless, you have to pursue the truth and help people to understand truth. And that is a thankless job, no? And the best prototype or ideal model to learn this is Maya. Nobody appraises Maya. Everybody criticizes her.
Durga.
People who know her, they criticize her. Like devotee community. But she accepts that. Because she is doing a service to Krishna, a thankless job. She knows that. So saint is like that. So he passes on renunciation, he passes on reward, the spirit, he passes on knowledge to his devotees. And this is one of Shikshashtakam is one of those eight prayers which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us. So we are on the third verse. And Krishna Kavya Swami writes here, Je Roop Laile Naam Prem Upjaye Tahar Lakshan Shroop Suno Shroop Ramaraya 3:20:20. We are there. Chaitanya Charitamrita and Delila. Krishna Kavya Swami says, Mahaprabhu continued, Krishna's Kavya Rajgo Swami says, O Sarup Damoda and Ramanand Raya, hear from me the symptoms of how one should chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra to awaken very easily one's dormant love of God. Now this is a very important verse, because this is a verse giving us sadhana. It is a verse, so Shikshashtakam prayers is divided into Sambandha Vidhaya Prayojan. So the first verse, Chetodarpana Marjanam and Nam Namakari, those are Sambandha. Those are telling us our relationship with Holy Name. Okay, what we expect from Him and what He expects from us. Both of it. So what we expect from Holy Name is the first verse. All the seven effects. And what He expects from us is offenseless chanting. That is second verse. Durdayevam iti rishyam yajalina anuraga. Mahaprabhu says, I don't have love in because I'm doing offenses. He expects that. So that's relationship, no? Both ways. And third verse is abhidhaya. And third, fourth, and fourth, fifth. So third verse is starting abhidhaya. So this verse is important because this verse, so then Krishna Goswami says, Tahar lakshan son charup namorai. Now, how to develop love very quickly? How to do that sadhana? Okay, chanting holy names we know, but how to chant holy names so that we can develop love? Now, that is one insight into sadhana, because we think sadhana is chanting, but no, how to chant, that's the point. Now, here's the point. Mahaprabhu says, we all know, third verse is Nadavi Suni Chena Taroda Saishinava, Manana Mandena Kirtana Sadhari. Okay. Now here's a question. Mahaprabhu says there are three qualities you need: humility, tolerance, and giving respects and not accepting respect. So we'll talk about that a little later. But all these three qualities follow one quality. Without that, you can't have these three qualities. So these three qualities, I'll talk about it, they are like attendants to that queen. That queen is, who is that?
Surrender or faith?
Yeah. Actually, yeah. Surrender or obedience. So surrender word is little vague if you talk about that. Surrender is okay if you know what surrender. But if you want to put in practical word and one word, that is obedience. You have to obey that. So you have to learn to obey. And that's what Krishna wants to see. There was a saint. And in fact, in all traditions, there are stories like this. So there was a saint, he was a Christian. And in Christian tradition, there is a particular tradition of fathers of desert.
Fathers of?
Desert.
Desert, okay.
So in Africa, North Africa, they have deserts, no Egypt and all these things. Mm-hmm. So there was Christianity took hold of that place. And they became fathers in the desert. And what they used to do is, they were very austere, that tradition. Unlike Catholics. And they used to stand on a pillar. Used to make a pillar in desert and stand on that whole life. They'll not come down. That's how they... And just praying. They were called fathers of deserts. And their teachings are very nice. So this one of the father, he had a disciple. So he said to the disciple, you go and there's a plant and you water that. And it was dead plant. Desert. So he didn't do. He said, what? You water a dead plant. And he told another disciple, he just went, he didn't really argue him. He just went and watered it. And kept on watering for 1 month. And after 1 month, flowers bloomed. And there was voice of God. And God said, I'm very happy with you. And not because you just followed him blindly. That's not the point. But the point was, you followed him as soon as he ordered you start following him. Without hesitation. That's the point. With lot of, what do we say, fervent enthusiasm and eagerness and fastness. So without any procrastination. And that's what God is looking for. That is obedience. That is obedience. Christ, I remember at the end when he was crucified, then he was saying that, oh Lord, forgive me, isn't it? And you
forgive
know
these sinners.
No, forgive me first, he said. And he said, forgive me because I hesitated for a moment to be crucified in my heart. And we know that in Bible. He was fighting, you know. And so he said, I am the greatest sinner. That's how they think, you know. I hesitated for a millisecond. So obedience is a mother of all, is a queen of all these qualities. And obedience, that comes from where? Something is going on. Okay. Obedience comes from where?
Faith.
Faith is a foundation of obedience. Obedience is a queen, and all these qualities are attendants. Now I'll talk about them later. Now, who is the mother of this queen? From where this queen is born? Faith is a foundation of that queen. And or you can say faith is a beauty of that queen. Without faith, she is not beautiful. She is ugly, isn't it? If you obey somebody without faith, it's an ugly affair. It's a business. It's a flattery, no? So, the mother of that queen is, yesterday I said, charity. And charity here doesn't mean in the normal sense of charity. All this kind of, you know. So, what's that called? What is it called? Helping others? Like,
you know, anthropo.
Yeah. PP se kuch hota hai, no? That's something from.
Anthropology.
No. Philanthropy.
Philanthropy.
So charity, it doesn't mean philanthropy. That's a wrong understanding, in fact. In fact, modern Christians took charity in terms of philanthropy, but if you go to original Greek word, the original Greek word, they translated as charity, but that exactly means self-giving. That's charity. You give your sense of I to God. And that's what he wants. Okay, I'm yours, you know. That's all, finish. And if you have that sense of giving yourself, then only there's a meaning of obedience, no? I'm yours. Okay, now, what do you obey? What do you order me? That's real obedience. So that is called selflessness in our Dharma Shastras. And everybody says, without selflessness, there is no meaning to religion. There is no meaning to religion. And that is why you see all Dharma Shastras, they teach us, they instruct us all those acts where you have to be selfless. And have to leave your selfishness, isn't it? They teach us that. Okay, fine. So you dig, king has to dig wells and this. And Grasta has to leave his comforts and, you know, guest, honor, guest. All these morals are based on this one concept of selflessness. And when the person gets sense of selflessness, okay, what is the meaning of selflessness? He likes selflessness. Then he says, fine, you know, I'm giving myself to this world and I'm so happy. If I give myself to God, how much happy will I become? And from that point, devotion. He associates with devotees and takes to devotion. That's an indirect method. So first morality, nishkam, karma and all these things. And then you come to spirituality. But of course Vyasadeva told Narada that, Narada Muni told Vyasadeva this is not going to work in Kali Yuga. From morality, people will never switch to spirituality. On the other hand, people will pull spirituality into morality. They'll convert. They're so dumb and so confused people. So you have to directly take them to spirituality. And that's a problem which Vyasadeva did. Isn't it first canto? Like for all these Mahabharata and all Puranas, they are just moral instructions. Of course, there are spiritual instructions, but those instructions are hidden. And you need an expert eye to extract them. So Narada Muni says, they don't have an expert eye. Manda sumanda matyo. Narada Muni says, you only mentioned in the beginning of Bhagavatam. And you made a mistake. So you directly tell what is spirituality. Don't confuse them. So that's where the scheme is there. Mother is selflessness or giving yourself to God. The child who has become a queen, that is obedience or surrender. And then which is followed by attendance. So the first attendant is humility. And humility is called as a nurse of surrender. Because just as a nurse serves the queen or nourishes the baby, you know. Now this queen is a baby now. Surrender. It's not mature now. You have to mature it now. So nurse helps us in that. Without humility, she doesn't get nourished. And tolerance is the sister or that nurse who comes to help. And giving respect to others is the brother.
Brother.
Yeah. So the whole family comes to help this obedience, to get nourished, to make it matured. So that's the scheme. So Mahaprabhu is talking about that, by the way. Now he's talking about these three attendants. And he says, Trinadapi suni chena tarore vaseshna amanina mandina kirtina sadhari. Now, this verse is important, and let's see, Mahaprabhu comments himself. Now, this explanation is very important. He says, Uttam hoya apna ke mane trinadham dui prakare sahishnuta kare vriksham. So he says, these are symptoms of one who chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Now, these three are required. Although he's very exalted, he thinks himself lower than a grass on the ground. This is humility. That's all. This is humility. So to become humble, you don't have to go down, you have to go up. And then humility makes a sense. You have to become advanced. So Mahaprabhu was so pleased by humility of Haridas Thakur, of Pratap Rudra. Like he was so happy with Pratap Rudra sweeping the floor. You know? Like before, many sweepers might also been sweeping the floor. He was not the first person. But he didn't care about them. So that's one thing. Real humble person is an advanced person. And the question is, how can an advanced person think himself fallen? That's a big question. Because we know we are advanced. Like if you're advancing, you know you're advancing. And you're seeing in the community, these other devotees, they're not chanting properly, they're not reading, and you're doing. And they are like sense gratification, but you're sort of, at least grossly out of it. So how does a devotee, advanced devotee, understand he's humble? What's the logic there? Or he's trying to like brainwash himself, no, I'm most fallen. Or he's trying to artificially say that.
The more someone is realizing, the more gap he sees in him.
No, but then a devotee thinks, I'm lower than the lowest.
Like, say for example, Krishnaraj, Kaviraj Goswami.
Yeah, he says, I'm in the warm in the stool.
And he felt it that way, correct?
So, he might be knowing, you know, he's not involved in gambling, intoxication, illicit. He's not there. But these guys, they are. So then, but why he's thinking I'm more fallen than them? How is it?
Knowingly, maybe till someone is ignorant and they are not doing it, is there grace? There is some grace mark given, but if someone knows and doesn't do it, then knowingly doing wrong is bad.
So? No, so there are many new devotees who are just being complete nonsense. So Krishna Brahma is saying, I am lower than a worm, what to say of them? So it seems like they are like, he's like, just saying, you know, just like that. But it's, for them, that's a reality. So how it goes is, because they are very near to God. And they know this. Because pastimes are getting revealed in their heart. They know, you know, it's not wrong. They know this. But at the same time, and they know this person is very far away. But the problem is, if he's in first class, you're in 12th class. So, expectations from God is more from you than him. And then the devotee thinks, okay, from his level, he's fulfilling those expectations. But from my level, I'm not fulfilling those expectations. That's why I'm more fallen than him. That's how the logic goes. I'm supposed to do much more, but I'm not doing my duty. He's doing that duty. So I'm useless. What am I doing? So Krishna, that's why these people think like that. So that is humbleness. And tolerance is, and Mahaprabhu explains tolerance. Vriksh jain kaatilen kichu na bolai, sukshm maila kare pani na mangai. This is beautiful. He says, when a tree is cut down, it does not protest. This is tolerance. In material world, we will be criticized by our own family members. That will happen. If that will not happen, Krishna will arrange it for you to help us develop the quality of tolerance, isn't it? So trees cut down, it does not protest. And that we have to learn. If somebody criticizes us, we should not protest. We should either give explanation if it is not demanded. If it's asked, okay. not asked. Okay, fine. That's okay. We accept. But that's a difficult part. When you're blamed, but then you don't speak back. But if you do that, Krishna will embrace you. Krishna will come and he will serve you, because that's impossible. Until unless we have a strong devotional background. Until unless we understand everything is arranged by Krishna, we will not be able to do it. So until unless we understand this, actually this person is not criticizing me, it's Krishna criticizing me through him. So how and to whom should I protest? What, so if he is criticizing me, what? So the wisdom there is to understand why Krishna is criticizing me. There's something wrong in me. So rather than looking wrong in him, it is an indication, a sign to look wrong in yourself and correct you. That's a tree. When a tree is cut down, it does not protest. Even while drying up, it does not ask anyone for water. So like we see in ISKCON, you know, many devotees, they are brahmacharis for many years and then they marry, isn't it? And they like politics and they are like frustrated. Or many congregation members also, by politics they are frustrated and they just leave. They don't discuss, they don't come back, chalo, ho gaya, that's it. But that's not a good thing, because even when you're drying up, drying up means you're not getting any juice from ISKCON. No, nothing, you know, you're not getting anything. It does not ask anyone for water. It still remains with devotees. This kind of devotee remains with them in spite of so many things. And it does not ask anything. He just keeps on serving. That's how a devotee, that's tolerance. So tolerance comes from forgiveness. Otherwise you can't be tolerant. So, okay, fine. You know. Forget and forget.
How to generate this?
Forget and forget.
Forgiveness.
That you can learn from children. Children have all bad quality. Bad quality in the sense. Naughty and this and this, shaitan. But they have this beautiful quality of forget and forgiveness. You scold them, you do anything, you slap them. For 5 minutes, they'll be... after 10 minutes, they are playing with you. Like nobody can do this, you know, except children. And how can children do that? Because they are happy within themselves. A child doesn't need anything to be happy. He can just sit in one corner and just play with himself. As a child, no. He's experiencing happiness from within himself. So if we experience happiness from within ourselves, we'll forget and forget. That's the only way. There's no other way. So, and the classical example is given, if you get a lottery of $3 billion and somebody blames you, okay, no problem. That's fine. You're so happy. $3 billion, chalo, kuch bhi kar lo, it doesn't matter. The lottery khul gayi. Oh, he'll slap
then
you.
Then people say you gambled.
That's another thing. But you imagine, if you have $3 billion lottery and some devotee comes and slaps you, you'll be so happy. You say, yeah, yahan pe bhi maar de, do aur maar de, kya farak pad raha hai? Doesn't matter, you know, I'm a billionaire. You'll be so happy. So that's how we can forget and forget. We can learn from children like that. And then, tree delivers its fruits and flowers, whatever else is possessed, it possessed to anyone, everyone. Actually, there's a book some Prabhupada disciple was, in Houston, one devotee was telling me, I forgot the name. So that book is written by a materialistic person. But that book is written on a tree. It is written on a tree. I think the book's name is the Tree. The whole thick book on tree. And he expands this idea. So in the end, he writes that even when you cut the tree and it dies and there's a log of wood, even after death, it is thinking how to serve you and it provides you a seat to sit on. That's a tree. So he delivers fruits, flowers and whatever else it possesses to anyone and everyone. And this is what is tolerance. Tolerance will help you to actually develop a quality of sacrifice. You will relish, people relish accumulating things. A devotee relishes, what can we say? Giving himself, giving things.
Charity.
Yeah, you can say like
gift
that.
Gift.
Yeah. A devotee relishes poverty.
Mm.
So tolerance is actually it'll help you to get that quality of poverty. You'll start relishing poverty. Not richness and greed and that's a different kind of relishment, no?
Mm.
When you have the best thing and you give it, okay, yes. So that happiness of giving cannot be compared to happiness of taking. And this is the problem, you know. If you ask materialist people, they'll say, we are happy.
Mm.
Now you can tell them, well, you are happy, but there are different kinds of happiness.
Mm.
And there's a happiness of taking which you're experiencing, that's okay, but there is a happiness of giving also. That you have not experienced. And you see, so that a devotee knows,
mm-hmm.
by the power of devotion, he knows. It's so happy to give to Krishna and to devotees. So devotee wants, devotee is like a tree. He will go to any extent to help devotees. That he can do, if that's required. He can do that. And he should do that. It tolerates scorching heat, torrents of rain. See? Still it gives shelter to others.
Mm.
So devotees' whole tolerance will produce, give you a quality of thinking. Your whole thought will be just centered around one thought. How should I help devotees? That's all. That's all. How should I help devotees and Krishna?
Mm.
That is real friendship. No? Suhirdam sarva bhutana. That's what our thing is. And you start thinking about devotee community, individual devotees. And that will, actually that is satisfying to the soul. Otherwise not satisfying, otherwise it becomes disgusting. So all this, you see so many qualities tolerance is giving us.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that is why it is said, there's a saying, if you get one virtue, all others follow with it. If you get one evil, all others follow with it. Simply, you have to get lust and everything follows. Anger, greed and we with it, because they are all attendants, no? And if you get one virtue, any of these, and all virtues are linked together.
It's a family.
Yeah, it's a family. If you get one member of the family, you get all of them. And that is why if you focus on any one of them, you get all of them. And that is the principle of this nine limbs of devotion, no? So if you follow any one limb, you get perfection. That's what devotion says. And the idea is if you follow kirtanam, all others will follow. So if you're interested in kirtanam, automatically you'll be interested in shravanam, smaranam and everything. You start from anywhere, you get all. So that's the beauty of virtues there. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then says the next verse, he says, kahite kahite prabhur dainya vaadela. When he was speaking, his humility increased. And why? The question is why? Now he spoke this verse and he became more humble. Why is that? Why? He simply speaking Shikshashtakam. We speak daily in the morning, nothing happens. But he is experiencing an emotional change in his heart. You see, when Krishna Goswami will point out, when he speaks this verse, what emotional changes comes. When he goes to fifth verse, other emotions are coming.
Mm-hmm.
And this is very important to understand, because that's actually Bhaktivedanta Thakur has written this book, Bhajan Rahasya. And in that he says how to chant on the basis of Shikshashtakam. Like every verse. So I didn't used to understand previously, like how to chant, you know, like using these verses. But then after you read this, you understand there are emotions behind these verses. And chanting is all about emotions. No, devotion is all about emotions, true emotions, not sentimental. Emotions has to be there. If you can't delete emotions, no. So these verses helps to develop favorable emotions for Krishna. One by one you practice, and then you advance, go one after another. So Mahaprabhu becomes, as he is chanting third verse, his humility increased, and he began to praying to Krishna that he could discharge pure devotional service. Shuddha bhakti Krishna thai mangite lagila. Now, why his humility increased? What do you say? You just speaking. That's all. That's all finished. You know why? Because he's speaking this, but then he's thinking in his mind that, well, I spoke all this, humbleness, tolerance, but I don't have all this. I don't have these qualities. And that's a devotee. Devotee will never, and whatever qualities I have now, humility, tolerance, that is also a mortgage. It's not mine. It's not, I have not, it is not born of me. Krishna has given me now to help me inspire. In fact, you know what? Krishna is intelligent, by the way. Why Krishna gives us these qualities? Why Krishna gives us sense control? Why he gives us all these qualities? Suppose you see a devotee is humble, tolerant, giving respect. So naturally we think he's advanced now. But from Krishna's perspective, it might be a very different game altogether. So why he's giving all these qualities? Because suppose we started getting these qualities, why he's giving? We might think because we qualify for those qualities, no? Like we are practicing. So Krishna is giving those qualities. When we become qualified, he'll slowly start giving those qualities. But that's not the point. From Krishna's perspective, it might be like that, but it might be a very different thing. Krishna, sometimes it is said, Krishna gives good qualities to his devotees out of fear. And he has one fear, that we might get spoiled. And we might leave him. So to ensure that we don't leave him, we weren't spoiled, he gives these qualities. Not because we qualify for that, but because he fears, you know, give them extra protection. Give them protection. These qualities protect us, no? So just like our children, isn't it? So just like our children, you leave them, you take them, and you go them to pick up. So they might think, we are so special. But actually, from your perspective, you know, you are trying to protect. You are thinking, you're a fool. You're not so special. You might get lost. These children, foolish children, they don't know what is material. He doesn't understand that perspective. And neither you will tell him that you're stupid, you know. That's why we are here. Well, he is thinking, I'm so special. So that's the point. So Krishna gives his qualities and sense control, not because we deserve that, really, but because he fears we'll fall down. So to protect us, he'll give all these things. And what is our duty is to protect. Sir. Yeah, he to protect us, he gives these qualities. Our duty is to protect these qualities and nurture them. He is giving this for protection, so we have to keep them carefully and not do anything so that we lose them. Otherwise, we'll fall down, isn't it? We'll fall down. Our protection is gone. So that's why Mahaprabhu is becoming humble, you see. He understands this concept. He understands. And he began praying to Lord Krishna that he could discharge pure devotional service. Now, he begins praying. And then this is, you see what he says. Premera subhav jaha premera sambandh. Very beautiful verse. Sei mane Krishna mor nahi prem gandh. So he says, wherever there is relationship of love of Godhead, it is natural symptom is that devotee does not think himself a devotee. Instead, he always thinks he has not even a drop of love for Krishna. That's very natural. If something else is happening, we are not devotee.
So why does it happen?
That if they have love, then they think we don't have a drop of love. Yeah. That is the nature of love. Premera Subhav. It is said, when you'll attain love, it is said you will never know that you have attained love or not. That's also said. Because when you attain love, you will think, I don't have love.
Mm.
That's the idea. So, that is one perspective to look at this. But Krishna Goswami says, that is the subhav of love. The more love you have, the more you think you don't have love. That is nature. But why that is a nature, that's another question.
Mm.
Why love acts like that? So what do you think? What is your thinking about that?
Love is like, we can say, anandam buddhi bardhanam. Like, you know, it's keep on increasing. So, whatever you have, it's like gets limiting, then the...
Oh, you are thinking like that.
I...
But he is saying, Krishna more nahi premera gandh. The more love you have, the more you think, I don't have even a drop of love.
Hmm.
That's how it goes.
Again, maybe we say, if when we get closer, we are seeing how Krishna loves us and we are not reciprocating.
That's the point. Mm. Yeah, because when you start loving Him, you start seeing how much Krishna is helping you.
Mm.
And you are not serving Him to that extent, so you think, oh, I don't have love. He loves me, but I don't have love for Him.
Mm.
And that's one understanding. That is Premera Subhav, because love, the basis of love is service. It is not exploitation. So everything is judged according to service. So that, and then you see, you know, you can't compare how much Krishna is doing for us and what we return. That's impossible, no? Once we start loving Krishna means, once you start loving Krishna, you start knowing Him. Isn't it? Love helps us to know Him. When you start knowing Him, you can understand, my God, He is doing so much for me at every second. And what I am doing? Just chanting 16 notes? Following 4 regs? Doing some preaching, some distribution? What is this? We can't do anything for Him in return. And devotee thinks, oh, I don't have love. You see, and Mahaprabhu also explains, and Prabhupada explains, Mahaprabhu says that it's absolutely sure I don't have love for you. Because even though I am so far from you and separated from you, I am not dying.
Mm.
And this is a proof I don't have love. The Vaishnavera Kriya Mudra Vigyana Ujhaye. We can't think, we can't know what they are doing, what they are thinking. So this is a proof.
Mm.
The fact we are alive, this is a proof we don't have love.
Mm.
This is a different understanding altogether. This is Premera Subhav. And with that emotions, Mahaprabhu speaks the fourth verse. So he feels so humble and now he prays for love.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so from humility is born another virtue, is born prayers. So when you're truly humble, your heart starts praying spontaneously. And so he starts praying. So to pray to Krishna, you can pray like that also. Like we are praying, like we are advised to pray. But then real prayers will come when the more we are humble, and the more we understand the concept of humility, the more automatically heart will start praying at every second. That's directly proportional. So, na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, kavitam, va jagadish kame, mama janmani janmaneshwari, bhaktar bhakte ahito kitvai. So beautiful verse. And Mahaprabhu says, my dear Lord Krishna, I do not want material wealth from you. These are all the things which... These are reward. These are direct reward. We'll say, you should pray like this. He'll say, come on, you know, we pray, give us our daily bread. And you are saying, I don't want wealth, I don't want followers, I don't want wife, I don't want any results of fruitive activities, that means I don't want success, name and fame. Who will? They're saying, you're crazy. You're crazy. I only pray that by a causeless mercy you give me pure devotional service to you, life after life. This is actually true prayer. So Krishna Consciousness Swami says, why he prays like this? Ati dainne pune mange dasse bhakti dan. So he is thinking himself as a conditioned soul. Mahaprabhu, considering himself as a conditioned soul of this material world, again expressed his desire to endow the service of the Lord. And that is the fifth verse. He repeats that. But now in a different fashion. So the idea is, prayer is one, engage me in your service. But it can manifest in different forms. And Mahaprabhu is giving two examples of that. So it's not a prototype thing, engage me in your service, engage me in your service. No. We pray like this, but then when we advance, this prayer takes many forms and different flavors, which Krishna tastes it. Because Krishna is supreme enjoyer. And he will like that, no? Just like he has many queens, many gopis. So he wants many prayers. But the base should be one. Engage me in your service. So Prabhupada gave us that prayer.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah. Please engage me in your service. Oh, Hare. And if we practice that, then many prayers will manifest from that. So he says, we know this prayer. Ainanda Dhanujakil Karam Patitam Mabisham Evam Bhatav Kripayata Papat Pankaja Sitaduli Sadrisham Vichintya. And Mahaprabhu commands, Tumar Nitya Das Muhi Tumara Pasariya. I am your servant, but I have forgotten your lordship. Padi Acho Bhavar Nave Maya Bhadhoya. Now I have fallen into ocean of nisains and I have been conditioned by external energy. You see, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is praying in humility, of course. But of course, this is reality for us. It's not. We are like that. And he acknowledges for us. So by through his causeless mercy, he is teaching us how to pray in our situation. Kripa kari kar more paad dhuli sam. Tumar sevak karon tumara sevan. It's simple, no, Bengali? We can understand. Engage me in your service as eternal lotus feet. Puna, now anyway, I'll stop here, but I'll just give a
So far invitation. It was, so we had sambandha.
So, and abhidhaya.
Abhidhaya.
Yeah. Now comes prayojan. And puna ati utkantha dainne hoila utkam. Now with humility comes eagerness. Natural humility and eagerness then awoke in Mahaprabhu. Now another component of emotion is adding, that is anxiety or eagerness to attain Lord. He prayed to Krishna to be able to chant Mahamantra in ecstatic love. This is prayojan, no? In love. So from obedience comes humility, and then other virtues follows. Humility comes prayers, and then from prayers comes eagerness. To attain that state of love. Intense longing. And then comes 6, 7, 8 verse. That is prayojan. So we can read this afterwards. And this is nice. Okay.
Keshunanda
Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Keshunanda Mahaprabhu ki jai.